Are you ready? Starship's sixth flight is scheduled to launch on Monday, but SpaceX still needs to finish many things before that can happen. Pad B is rapidly approaching completion. It will be a game changer. Starship's launch cadence for 2025 is ramping up fast. How much exactly will this already change the industry? Blue Origin is finally ready to launch, and even more people are entering the reusability game, with some of them appearing to have copied others' homework. My name is Felix, welcome to What About It? Let's dive right in. Starship updates. Flight 6 is just days away, and it's all hands on deck here at Starbase. Work has been happening around the clock, with teams reviewing almost everything in preparation for yet another groundbreaking launch. Of course, that is figuratively groundbreaking, as we are long past the days of concrete tornadoes and tunnel-digging starships. That's because SpaceX installed its water-cooled steel plate, which sprays water directly up at the booster to protect itself from the heat and pressures of launch. This system is vital for a successful flight of Starship from this launch pad. Without it, the force of the engines would put a crater in the ground and could damage the booster engines as well. We saw SpaceX perform one more pre-flight check with the water deluge system spraying from the plate to ensure all systems work properly before the upcoming flight. There was no guarantee that all the systems required for this flame deflector to function properly survived Flight 5, and the same can be said about almost every piece of the launch pad. We're not 100% sure here at Y, but it looks like more water was coming out this time. Have they increased the pressure? SpaceX has made significant progress in making the pad more reusable. They've upgraded and improved this launch mount after every flight, and this time is no different. After Flight 5, SpaceX spent little time preparing this mount for Booster 13's static fire. Even though it is operational, that doesn't mean that work is complete. Over the past few days, we've seen workers on every part of the OLM. Most of these changes are likely upgrades, such as here, where SpaceX workers are welding more shielding onto the booster quick disconnect housing. They're building a tank. This housing is designed to protect the BQD during launch. However, it doesn't typically do the best job. We've seen the internal piping replaced numerous times, and when the housing is open, you can even see areas where it's clear hot gases have leaked in. The other work we've seen SpaceX doing is painting the legs of the launch mount. This paint is often torn away following each flight and needs to be replaced. While this may seem like a waste, the paint adds an extra layer of protection against the heat of a launch, and without it, these legs, which mainly consist of concrete-reinforced steel pipes, would begin to rust and rapidly degrade. While it may not seem like paint is much more than just a cosmetic consideration, it can be vital to ensure the long-term health of many components. The launch mount is one of many that need to be in good shape for the launch. Another one are the chopsticks. Not only are they used to stack the ship and booster on the launch mount, but now they are also used to catch the booster. This is why we've also seen work being done on the actuator hydraulics for the arms. This is likely checks and calibrations to ensure everything is ready for yet another catch attempt, as the precision and speed required for that is much greater than what is needed to lift a vehicle onto the launch mount. Interestingly, the ship's quick disconnect is one area where we've yet to see any major work completed. This required a substantial amount of work after every previous launch, with pipe and actuator replacement being fairly common. However, that has not been the case at all after Flight 5, which may mean SpaceX has finally managed to find a way to protect this fairly fragile component. If this is the case and Flight 6 ends up launching with no repairs to this happening, then that means SpaceX is one step closer to rapid reusability. This is also a good sign for Pad B's SQD, which has a similar design. Speaking of Pad B, we've seen quite a bit of work being done on both the tower and the launch mount in this area. Much of the tower's prep work is complete now, as cranes have begun removing the work platforms and catch nets installed to facilitate this construction phase. Yes! Yes! This means we may soon see the chopsticks and SQD rolling out for stacking, possibly shortly after Flight 6. In fact, we even saw a sign that this was fast approaching, as on the 12th we saw this being rolled to Pad B. This is the drawworks motor for the second orbital launch tower. That's a very important piece. It is typically used for work on oil rigs. However, SpaceX has repurposed it and now uses it as the lifting motor for the chopsticks. This motor is placed in these housings at the tower's base and connected by a cable that runs to the top of the tower through multiple pulley systems all the way to the chopsticks. This allows the relatively small motor to easily raise and lower the chopsticks with a Starship or booster resting on them. Around the tower, it's a similar story. SpaceX has continued excavating the ground for the new flame diverter, which is supposed to be a much more reusable and reliable alternative to the water-cooled steel plate used on Pad A. However, building this adds quite a bit more time and complexity to the overall construction of the launch pad, which is likely why SpaceX wanted to avoid it if possible. You just have to take a look at Pad 39A and B here at Kennedy Space Center to know that these pads are difficult to build. Of course, this is just the flame trench. The launch mount is being built separately at the Sanchez site and it's rapidly progressing. The last time we looked at this launch mount, it had just received the four corner pieces. And after the last two side pieces were rolled in, they began installation as well. SpaceX was not playing around when it came to installing these, as it took them no time at all. The final major piece of the second segment was placed into position the night of the 12th. However, you can see they still have a small gap between the sections, but this should be filled in easily and we may have already seen the parts to do so. It is coming along very quickly. With the main structure now complete, teams will be able to install most of the internal hardware, including the hold-down clamps and internal piping, as well as the water-cooled launch deck to protect it. Turning our attention from future ground hardware to future flight hardware. Yet another barrel segment has been rolled into Mega Bay 1. This is for booster 16, which is currently under construction in this bay and is growing rapidly. This booster is now over half built, with 16 of its 24 rings constructed. It will be done and ready to fly in no time, which truly speaks to how quickly SpaceX is working. Interestingly, this does not appear to be a Block 2 booster yet, and SpaceX may be waiting till they get more data on booster landing to implement even more upgrades.
Even better.
SpaceX uses a highly iterative design process, which makes every new vehicle different from the last. Turning our attention back to Flight 6, we can see that clearly with Ship 31. Let's do a comparison. But before I tell you about that, we've looked into our channel metrics, and there are over 2 million returning monthly viewers who have not subscribed yet. We just hit 500,000 subscribers, 500,000 of you. Help us improve the channel even further by double checking that you've hit that subscribe button so you don't miss our updates. And while you're at it, give us a like and become a Y supporter. Why? Because you'll gain access to a massive amount of extra content. With it, you get access to daily new Starbase photo galleries, including all those we've posted so far. Satellite, aerial, and ground photos. More than 400 posts in the past 2 years alone, with up to 7 picture galleries per week. Insights, chats with me, you name it. Thank you so much, you rock. Now back to Ship 31 and Flight 6. Ship 31 has seen numerous changes, specifically to its heat shield, as SpaceX works to test as much as possible on this flight. There are likely countless changes, both large and small, to the overall heat shield, but we know only a few. For example, we know this ship will be tested with a new backup ablative heat shield layer, which will differ from the one used on Ship 30. Many tiles have been removed on each side of the heat shield to perform tests regarding its future reusability. Considering this will be the last Block 1 ship to fly, SpaceX wants to complete as many tests as possible before it begins flying its Block 2 ships. It will be a bittersweet moment when this ship's journey finally comes to an end in just a few days, as this overall design has stayed fairly consistent over almost 4 years of flight tests, starting with the high-altitude test prototype SN8 in 2020. Man, time's been flying. I hope they keep at least one Block 1 ship around so it can be put in a museum one day. After Flight 6, there will only be 2 left, ships 20 and 32. However, progress needs to continue. The SpaceX machine keeps marching on. On the nights of the 11th, scaffolding was removed from around Ship 31 before the roads were closed. Initially, it appeared that the booster would be rolling first, as much of the scaffolding had still been built up around the ship until the day before. However, that clearly wasn't the case, as we saw the ship make its way out of the high bay and down the road to the launch site. Once it arrived, it was placed at a temporary holding location while it waited for the booster to arrive as well. This is exactly what happened on the 13th when the second road closure that we originally thought would be for the ship came into effect. Both the booster and the hot staging ring rolled out of the mega bay and down Highway 4. It then arrived at the launch site where it was placed between the arms of the chopsticks. Quickly after being lifted into the air, it found itself once again on top of the launch mount. Only this time it's for an actual launch in a record amount of time. When they finally rolled this booster out to the pad, the scheduled launch date was only 5 days away, so it's no surprise that SpaceX quickly prepared the ship for stacking as well. Shortly after the booster was placed on top of the launch mount, the ship rolled from its storage area between the arms of the chopsticks. More free hugs! It was then also lifted into the air and placed on top of the booster, ready for its wet dress rehearsal. All systems are set to flight readiness and go through the countdown sequence similar to what would be experienced up until just a few seconds before liftoff. This is the final test needed to verify a vehicle's readiness for launch. Given SpaceX's rapid pace of work, this WDR is expected to happen any day now if it hasn't already happened by the time you're watching this. If the WDR turns out to be a success, the next and final step will be to de-stack the ship from the booster so workers can access it and install the flight termination system designed to safely end the flight if the vehicles shouldn't behave the way SpaceX wants them to. Imagine being a Starship. If you don't do all the tricks correctly, you get blown up. Once the flight termination system is installed, the ship will be restacked. On the 18th, just 3 days after this video is released, this vehicle should take to the skies to close out an entire era of Block 1 ships. It is sure to be a spectacular sight, especially as we not only have the booster landing to look forward to yet again, but now we will also be getting some incredible daytime views of the ship re-entering and hopefully splashing down safely yet again in the Indian Ocean. With Starship quickly approaching full reusability, it's on track to revolutionize the space industry, and it will likely do it even more than the Falcon 9 did when it first came to market. The problem for the rest of the space industry, of course, is that they still haven't even caught up with Falcon 9. So Flight 6 will end the Block 1 Starship era, but what will Block 2 bring? Let's put this into perspective to open some eyes for what's to come. We know that Starship Block 2 will roughly be able to carry 100 tons to low Earth orbit. We also know that a Falcon 9 carrying Starlink satellites takes around 17.5 tons of payload to space each time, because that's roughly the weight of a stack of 24 Starlink V2 mini satellites. By far the heaviest payload SpaceX launches into space. Let's assume for a moment that SpaceX would completely max out every Falcon 9 launch with those 17.5 tons of a Starlink V2 mini launch. Now, here comes the mind blower. Assuming 150 Falcon 9 launches in 2025, that's 2,625 tons of payload to low Earth orbit. Now, we know that SpaceX aims for 24 Starship launches in 2025. Assuming that Block 2 can carry 100 tons each launch, that's 2,400 tons from Starship, effectively almost doubling SpaceX's payload to orbit capability. So even though Starship is still not even fully developed, as the Block 3 variant is supposed to carry 200 tons each launch, and even though the launch cadence isn't nearly at 3 launches per day, which is SpaceX's goal, Starship will already be almost on par with Falcon 9 in 2025, if this calculation is somewhat correct. Starship will change everything. Let's go even crazier for a second. Let's dream big. If SpaceX ever achieves its 200-ton goal and a launch cadence of 3 launches per day, that would send 219,000 tons to low Earth orbit each year. 83 times the payload possible with all Falcon 9 launches in a year together. As a fun fact, that's also more than 520 times the weight of the ISS. Falcon has changed the space industry as a reliable, cheap, and versatile rocket family, allowing it to undercut and outperform every other rocket on the market by a significant margin. Very few in the industry were prepared for how revolutionary the Falcon 9 would be, and even fewer were working on new technology to compete. However, some still had the foresight to begin working on reusable rockets around the same time as SpaceX. One of those companies is Blue Origin, and while they may tend to lag a bit behind, they are still miles ahead of the rest of the competition with their reusable New Glenn rocket, which is set to launch soon. And in preparation for that launch, it's been fully assembled for the first time ever. In a post on X, Blue Origin shared these amazing photos of the two stages finally meeting for the fully assembled rocket. This is the first ever look at a fully assembled flight hardware New Glenn. This vehicle is now ready for its static fire and wet dress rehearsal, then all that's missing is the fairings and this thing is ready to fly. I am so looking forward to this. Unfortunately, not everyone can be so lucky. The European Space Agency has been completely caught off guard by how rapidly SpaceX devoured the market share with its low price, high reliability, and high performance reusable Falcon family of rockets. That's why it's no surprise that they are finally putting some money behind this innovative technology that SpaceX has been pioneering for nearly a decade now. In a recent announcement, the European Space Agency awarded four companies contracts to begin the initial stages of development for a reusable rocket. This is only an initial contract. From here, these companies will continue negotiating with ESA to determine which company or companies have the best design to move forward and begin receiving more money to develop and build these rockets. While it's clear that this is a reactive response rather than a proactive one in the face of SpaceX taking away a large fraction of the European Space Agency's and Arianespace's customer base, it is still a positive sign and a move in the right direction. It helps push this technology forward and greatly helps Europe's space efforts. After all, Europe is just one of many places where this is happening. Looking across the globe, many companies are attempting to copy SpaceX. Some are a bit more blatant than others, such as the Chinese startup Cosmo Leap. They just finished a $14 million round of funding to develop their rocket. This startup has some ambitious goals of having test flights in 2025 or 2026. That's like tomorrow in spaceflight terms. However, they still have a lot of catching up to do. It's clear they are serious about this, as shortly after they raised all of this money, they shared this. Yep, that is a catch tower. Despite this looking like a render, as you can see here, the cable and many other parts of the tower shift over time as the chopsticks are moved up and down, as well as many other clues that point to this being real. The video they shared is hard to make out much detail from as the quality is less than stellar, but we can tell a lot. For starters, we could tell that this is not intended to catch a rocket, ever. If you look behind it, you can see quite a few buildings. That's because this appears to be a prototype built in a city. And you can't exactly launch, let alone catch a rocket in the middle of a city, not even in China. You can land them there though. Sorry, that was a bad one. The scale of this also appears to be quite a bit smaller than that of Mechazilla, with it only appearing to be around half the width and only about a quarter to a third of the height. For reference, here you can see an internal ladder for people to climb up and down, and here's a similar ladder on Mechazilla. This is clearly just a tech demonstrator, and it doesn't even appear the chopsticks are capable of closing at the moment, as no pistons or actuators can be seen. However, it is a start. Also, if you thought companies were the only ones directly trying to copy Starship in China, you would be wrong. The Chinese National Space Agency has been working on a super heavy lift rocket that appears to share some similarities in concept to a certain other rocket from SpaceX. This is China's current concept design for the Long March 9, which China aims to fly in early 2030 and plans the first reuse around 2033 to 2035. A tower will also catch this methane-fueled rocket. However, as you can see here, the plan on doing it is slightly different, with four smaller towers and two moving rails. Kind of like a 3D printer setup, it'll enable them to utilize the entire array footprint as a landing surface. SpaceX moves fast, and others attempt to follow as fast as possible. Seeing such copies pop up was to be expected. However, competition is needed, as it forces others to innovate to keep up. Right, ESA? That's it for today. Remember to smash that like button. Subscribe for more. This is what fuels the algorithm, and this is how you can help us for free. Check out our epic shirts in your favorite space nerd store, a new Raptor design, and our epic brand new Flight 6 design with a banana for scale are both up. The perfect Christmas gift. Link is in the description and in the card you should see now. And if you want to train your space IQ even further, watch this video next to continue your journey. Thank you very much for watching, and I'll see you again in the next episode.
The legs.
Four corner pit. Oble. Ha ha ha.